Hachette Books Ireland presents A Lesson in Malice by Catherine Kirwan. Read by Eileen Walsh. Saturday. Annabel Leahy had just turned 17, and for a long time she had been top of her class. The arrival of new girl Zoe Harris had changed everything. Zoe Harris and her willowy blondness and her perfectly accented French and her genius-level maths and her A-pluses in English. Barely 6 months into the school year and the top student award that Annabel had won easily for the last 4 years straight was slipping further and further out of reach, even though she worked as hard as ever. Late at night, every night, in the privacy of her bedroom, Annabel cried. And she was tired of crying. So, she showered early and blow-dried her hair, pulled on her favourite black leggings, the ones that made her belly disappear, and wore lenses instead of glasses, even though the contacts made her eyes sting. After a light breakfast, sourdough toast with a scrape of hummus, which Annabel considered a more planet-friendly spread than butter, she cancelled her Saturday morning chemistry Zoom study group and left the house in the small 1970s estate where she lived with her parents and two younger brothers. She told her mother only that she was going for a ramble, a breath of fresh air. She said she didn't know where she might go. But she did. Striding quickly downhill from Shanakeel and on through Sunday's Well, she entered the narrow gap between two high walls. Descending the steps to the river, she crossed the north channel of the Lee via the pedestrian suspension bridge universally known as the Shaky. She did not pause to sample the characteristic wobble, as Cork people invariably do, or to admire the gracious period homes and the long, lush gardens overlooking the water. Barely glancing right and left, she crossed Western Road and the small slatted footbridge over the south channel of the river. After a restorative uphill pull through the Brookfield Medical Faculty Complex, she turned onto College Road. It was student party central all around this area for most of the year, apart from the little convent of the Poor Clares, where the nuns depended on donations and never left their compound and were so old-fashioned they probably didn't even have Wi-Fi, and further along, the Bon Secours. A large private hospital founded by a different order of nuns who, Annabel guessed, weren't remotely poor. She made her way to the main campus and kept going until she came to the quad, four perfect squares of lawn divided by neat gravel paths, surrounded on three sides by buildings open to the south. A polished brass plate inscribed President's Office gleamed on one of the three doors to the east wing, which was closed, as it always was at the weekend, but the other two wings were open. Walking amid the carefully tended shrubs and herbs and climbers and the old stone that was the same colour as the sky, Annabel felt calmer than she had in weeks. She checked the time. 3 minutes to 10. As a weak sun struggled through the clouds, she sat on a bench and shut her eyes. She told herself that none of Zoe Harris's achievements, however stellar they might be, had anything to do with her. Annabel would still get the grades she needed. She'd still be able to study medicine and specialise in paediatrics. Probably. Or become a GP. Maybe. Whatever. The details didn't matter. The point was that, in less than 2 years, she'd be here, in UCC, every day. And the misery that Zoe Harris had caused would be ancient history. Time passed, and Annabel started to feel cold. She rose from her seat and went inside to the Aula Maxima. Pausing, she inhaled the silence. Before now, she'd been here only when the hall had been full with other students from her school on the college open day. They hadn't been allowed up to the gallery, though they'd been shown the narrow door off the corridor and the steep steps immediately behind it. They'd been told that, for health and safety reasons, it was closed to tour groups. That they were lucky to see the stairs. Luck wasn't something Annabelle believed in, either the good or the bad kind. She believed in science and in hard work. But Zoe Harris, moving from Dublin and rolling into Annabelle's class at Mount Mercy, that was just random. Which, when you thought about it, was another word for luck. Annabelle walked towards the back of the room, running her fingertips along the grating that protected the shelves of musty leather-bound books. It was darker underneath the gallery, and the air was denser there, thicker. When she reached the internal door to the east wing, she pressed her palm against it. It opened. She went through it and walked quickly to the far end of the corridor, trying most of the doors with her left hand as she passed. They were locked. Returning more slowly the way she'd come, she noticed an odd, unnameable odour. And she remembered the little door to the gallery. She hadn't tried that one. She went to it, stood for a moment. The smell seemed stronger here. She pressed her nose to the wood. Definitely stronger. She turned the knob. The door creaked as it fell open. She took a single step, but went no further. Because blocking the cramped staircase was a man, wedged against the steps, hunched in a position incompatible with life, bloated, starting to leak. It took several seconds for her brain to analyse what she was seeing. Then a scream began in Annabelle's throat that she forced herself to swallow. Wrapping her scarf tightly over her mouth and nose, she turned her back on the open, bloodshot eyes, on the gathering stench. She called 999. Got the words out, somehow? No, she was sure that an ambulance wouldn't be needed, just the Gardaí. She ended the call and waited. Preserved the scene, kept vigil with a corpse, tried to say a prayer. Couldn't. And she couldn't help thinking that, whoever he was, no one had come looking for him. That he had been left to die. To decay like a rotting magpie she'd seen once on the riverbank at the far end of the leaf fields where the footpath runs out and, in summer, the vegetation grows wild and high enough to make it scary if you're a girl on her own. Annabelle had almost forgotten that magpie. But she would never forget the dead man's red, staring eyes. 3 days previously. Chapter 1. That damp Wednesday in April, I walked from Western Road through the ornamental ironwork gates that marked the main entrance to the campus. Before leaving my house less than half an hour earlier, I'd scraped my long, thick black hair into a tight, high ponytail. It swished back and forth as I moved, reminding me that I should have washed it. 9:15, and the avenue was busy with staff and students, all on foot, all trudging forward without visible enthusiasm. Some branched off via the stone staircase towards the south. I kept on, up the curving slope, edged with mature greenery and trees that met in the middle. Ahead of me, where the ground flattened, lay my destination. But I was early, and so, to kill time, swerved right in the direction of a small paved viewing promontory by a wall topped with railings. Gripping the narrow vertical bars, I peered over the cliff edge into the watery meadows below and the wrinkled Lea rushing eastwards. I wished for a little wooden boat, a blue one. I saw myself floating with the current under bridge after bridge, past the tip of the island and the mouth of the harbour, as far as the open sea. Except I had this thing to do. A thing I should never have said yes to in the first place. Turning, I passed over grass and tarmac and up the 7 steps and through the carved limestone Gothic doorway that was the rear entrance to the Aula Maxima, one of the university's original buildings. Unbuttoning my charcoal raincoat, I emerged from the short vestibule into the hall, large, vaulted, book-lined. Parallel to the back wall, a table with a floor-length white cloth was set up with stacks of cups and saucers and a Burko boiler. Along the side wall, above the bookshelves, huge, pointed, north-facing windows lit the space, empty but for the wall of past presidents' portraits, all male, staring darkly down from their gilt frames. Moving up the aisle briskly, between the banks of seating to the front, I sent a text message. In the aula, am I in the right place? Seconds later, the reply came. Through the left-hand door at the back of the dais, coffee and other fortifications await. A sudden loud noise, as if a book had fallen off a shelf, startled me. I jerked, swung a half-circle on my heel. But the room was as empty as it had been, and I found no likely source for the disturbance, although, it has to be said, I didn't look very hard. I went on about my business and thought little of what had happened, putting it down to a cross-draft, a creak of the old wood. With the benefit of hindsight, I see how wrong I was that morning, about how the day would go, about what I would do that evening, about nearly everything. Chapter 2. The other fortifications turned out to be the conference attendee's friend, an artery-clogging array of mini-pastries, croissants, pain au chocolat and the like. I stress-ate a couple in quick succession and washed them down with an unwise quantity of black coffee. We were in an over-furnished, peach-coloured room. The chief organiser of the event, Agnes Heaney, a former classmate who'd roped me in close to the last minute when one of her other speakers had had to cancel, various other people who seemed to belong, and me. "I've never been in here before," the thin man standing beside me said. I'd noticed him a few minutes earlier, chatting with Agnes. He'd worked the room briefly, nodding and smiling, before coming to a halt by the buffet table. He was my height, 5'8", and looked about 30. He wore a slim-fitting navy suit, white shirt, red tie, and pointy tan leather shoes. I had on a navy suit and white shirt too, though my suit was pinstriped and the skirt was too tight, thanks to the 10 pounds I'd gained in the past few months, and I was wearing flat black shoes. I can't be doing with heels lately. Or earrings.
"Have you?"
"No," I said. I bent my head to read his name tag.
"Sean?"
Too quickly. "Sennan," he said. "Dr. Sennan Dunford. I know who you are. Finn Fitzpatrick. He spoke with a flat Limerick accent. He had a nice face and the kind of charm people called boyish. Though it might have been the communion suit. All he was lacking was a white rosette. He went on, I'm down from Limerick for the day. But I did my undergrad degree here. I went sideways at it, did commerce at the start, hated it except for the law bits, got a transfer from Comm to the School of Law in the end. Took a while. Certain people didn't lay out the welcome mat."
He made a face, tipped his head in the direction of Professor Martin Casey, the dean of the faculty who had taught me property law, just then harvesting another pastry from the buffet. I remembered him as a great lecturer of an unpopular and difficult but necessary subject. Strict, though. Demanding. I could see how he might rub a person up the wrong way. "What do you do in Limerick?" I asked.
I'm attached to the law school at UL. Came down this morning. Oh, the traffic. They really need to do something about that road."
"Right."
There was no way I was getting dragged into a discussion on the controversial stalled Cork-Limerick motorway project.
"I'm sorry, Sennan. I have to, check the timetable with Agnes."
"I have a spare," he said, and swiftly handed me a typed lilac A4 sheet. "You're in the first panel, speaking second. After me, in fact."
"That soon?" I grabbed my bag from the side table where I'd left it. Too much coffee. I need to... See you inside. Looking forward to your paper. I gave what I hoped was a regretful smile and slipped out the side door into the stone corridor, an enclosed cloister containing the high point of the UCC walking tour, 27 ancient ohm-inscribed pillars as straight and silent as a platoon of soldiers on inspection. Dim daylight filtered through the diamond-leaded glass windows. After washing my hands, I stood by the sink and checked my script again, cobbled together from my notes on a recent high-profile murder case I'd been involved with. New perspectives, the view from a very peculiar practice, was no more impressive than it had been the last time I'd read it. I drew a diagonal line through an especially weak paragraph and folded over the pages. I dug an old lipstick out of the bottom of my bag, Russian red. It went on smoothly and took some of the grim off my face. But I was about to wipe it off again when the door behind me opened. "There you are," Agnes Heaney said. She dashed into a stall and locked it. Smaller than me and heavier than the last time I'd seen her, she had a faded, flyaway, mousy bob that could have done with a trim or a run of the straightener. She wore a baggy, piled, black-knitted dress that made my dull suit look designer. Through the door, Agnes said, "You're hanging around for dinner, aren't you?" I said, "I'll stay for as much of the conference as I can. I'm sure it'll be..." "So, I was thinking, I'll head away, not immediately, of course, but maybe later on this morning?" There was no maybe about it as far as I was concerned. I had a pile of work waiting for me back at the office, and that night, a hot date, with a takeaway and my Netflix account. But when Agnes came out of the cubicle, she'd gone pale. She grabbed my upper arm, her fingers pressed into the bone. "Whether either of us likes it or not, you're here now," she said. "You have to stay. All day. And the evening." Quickly, she ran cold water over her hands. She didn't stop to dry them. "Come on," she said. In the long months since the events of that day, I've become convinced that if only I'd asked her at that point, she might have told me. That if I'd known sooner, it might have changed what happened later. Instead, to avoid the temporary discomfort of an argument, I said nothing. On such seemingly insignificant decisions, the world turns. Chapter 3. When we returned, the front half of the hall had filled with a smattering of students and eager postgrads, various lecturers from the law school and visiting conference participants from other Irish universities and overseas. Mercifully, there were no local solicitors or barristers present to watch me making a holy show of myself, though some might sign in later to collect a few continuing professional development hours before being unavoidably called back to the office. CPD points accepted, the conference, lies and consequences, whither the rule of law in a post-truth world, was too highfalutin to attract the interest of most lawyers in practice, and too vague. Or maybe that was the point. Make the topic flexible enough for speakers from differing specializations to get away with rabbiting on about it for 20 minutes. It was going to be a long morning. Agnes went to the lectern and tapped at the microphone. A very young, curly-haired man in a headset wearing an open red checked shirt and a grubby Thin Lizzy t-shirt and carrying a small handheld video camera stepped forward to assist her. They seemed to know one another well. I glanced around and spotted a second, more professional-looking camera on a tripod being operated by a man in a suit. At some point in the future, my speech, or extracts from it, would probably surface on YouTube. I winced. I definitely should have washed my hair. Throughout all of this, Professor Martin Casey was sitting in the front row, tutting loudly and shaking his jowly head like a disappointed clergyman. I took a seat with the rest of the speaker panel at the far side of the platform between Senan Dunford and a woman I hadn't yet been introduced to. Beside her was a man I hadn't met before either. They each shook my hand in turn and murmured their names. Surreptitiously, I glanced at the programme. Dr. Beatrice Membe lectured at Pantheon Assas, University in Paris. Dr. Padraig O'Flaherty at the University of Galway. Any other day, I wouldn't be breathing the same legal air as these people. I didn't have a master's degree, let alone a doctorate. A jack-of-all-trades, I worked out of a tiny attic room at MLC, a corporate law office in the centre of town, barely tolerated by the partners because the fees I generated were considered too pathetically low to justify my employment. I was retained for the simple reason that I was useful. Useful for cleaning up the multifarious messes that tended to arise every now and again for the staff and clients of a big firm like ours, and that none of the other solicitors would deign to touch. Also, over the last while, I'd developed a sideline in investigative work. It was one of those cases that Agnes had asked me to talk about. She'd called me on my work number on Friday of the previous week. My surprise at hearing from her had intensified as she delivered her request. We'd been in the same year at UCC, neither friends nor enemies, mixing in different circles apart from a few shared tutorial groups. She was intelligent and focused, quietly on her way to first-class honours from day one, but always helpful to everyone else, sharing her spectacularly comprehensive notes, willingly, if anyone happened to miss a session. That kindness was surely at the root of my inability to say no to her. That, and the thought that if Agnes was asking me, of all people, she and the law school, to which I owed some fealty, had to be badly stuck. Plus, she'd been forceful on the phone. I hadn't felt like I had a choice. I'd been left with a very definite impression that another speaker had cancelled late and that she needed me to fill in. I wondered about that now. Had she mentioned a name? Going over the conversation in my mind, I became sure that she hadn't, and that she'd never actually used the word cancelled. Taking out the timetable Senan had given me, I ran my finger down the schedule. All of the other events had three contributors. Ours, the opening session, was the only one with four. Even more oddly, I was listed as a special guest. Yet the way she'd spoken in the bathroom had me thinking she hadn't wanted me here at all, that she'd been stuck with me. I looked up from the page at Agnes, saw her properly for the first time. Too shabby for her big day. Too pasty-faced to be healthy. My pulse quickened. Something strange was going on. Chapter 4. I was intrigued. If Agnes hadn't wanted me to come, she had to have had another reason for the invitation. Presumably, she'd let me know what it was eventually. But until my speech was done, I had to concentrate on that. Agnes made the usual contradictory opening remarks, welcoming everyone with one hand and, with the other, imparting dire warnings on escape routes in the event of fire or other cataclysmic events. She spoke succinctly, assuredly. She'd been doing this kind of thing a while. She'd published several books. Whatever was wrong, her work couldn't be the problem. After less than 5 minutes, she gave way to Professor Casey. "Settle in," Senan Dunford beside me muttered. "He may be some time." He was. Effusive gratitude to all distinguished guests, special mention for the event sponsor, L'Exponet Investments, an ethical fund, according to the conference programme, that had a well-established and mutually beneficial relationship with the law school. And a particular welcome with a round of applause for their CEO, Nathaniel Simpson, in the front row, directly in front of the lectern, a sleek, bald man with a tan, wearing an expensive open-neck white shirt with the sleeves rolled up and a chunky watch with a steel bracelet. Long pauses for brow wiping and water sipping, all followed by an almost interminable exposition of his own thoughts on the conference topic. "The rest of us might as well pack up and go home," Sennan said. I disguised a laugh as a cough. Casey paused and glared at no one in particular. But as the fidgeting and throat clearing in the audience increased, had the good sense to declare the conference well and truly open, and to finish. Sennan Dunford was next. Agnes retook her place at the microphone to introduce him. She spoke with real warmth, reciting his academic achievements, the scholarly articles he'd written, and that he was just completing a fellowship at the University of Limerick. So that's what he'd meant when he'd said he was attached to the department up there. It looked like the poor guy would be out of a job soon. In the circumstances, it had been decent of Agnes to give him the opening slot. But he was good. Nervous at the start, he grew more confident as he went on. His presentation was lucid, expertly put together. He spoke well and with a conviction that was refreshing, as if he was sure that what he had to say was worth hearing. If he managed to get a post somewhere, I reckoned he'd grow into the kind of expert-on-everything academic who'd turn up on radio panel shows and talking head documentaries. For all kinds of reasons, in Ireland, such academics were rarely female. At the end of Sennan's presentation, Agnes spoke again and invited another round of applause, saying, "You can all see why we're writing a book together. He'll keep me on my toes." Watching Professor Casey's response, I was mildly surprised to note that he seemed to be clapping as enthusiastically as everyone else. It looked like the grudge went only one way. As the room stilled, Agnes said, "And now, our special guest, a graduate of UCC, a solicitor, and, in more recent times, an amateur sleuth, ladies and gentlemen, Finn Fitzpatrick." I gave silent thanks for the brevity of the introduction and made my way slowly to the podium. Although I couldn't shake the nagging sense that coming here had been a mistake, I told myself that, in 15 minutes, my self-imposed ordeal would be over. Adjusting the microphone, I moistened my lips and started to speak. Chapter 5. Despite, or because of, the fact that it bore more resemblance to a true crime documentary than an academic paper, my speech appeared to go down well with most of the audience. I retook my seat and Agnes waited by the lectern. When the clapping ceased, she began her introduction of Beatrice Membe, a lengthy note of achievements and qualifications. Beatrice was stylish. She wore a fitted purple wrap dress, her black, naturally curly hair fanned out from her head like a halo, held back at the front by a pink headband that exactly matched her lipstick. When she spoke, her English was flawless, with a barely there French accent. In her opening remarks, she said that she intended to talk about how moral concepts of truth and honesty related to the legal duty to disclose relevant information. After listening to a few crisply delivered sentences, I zoned out and heard hardly a word she said. I had cause to regret my inattention later, but at the time, I was mentally berating myself again. On the Friday afternoon that the phone call had come from Agnes, I'd called into Gabriel's office to discuss a few ongoing cases. Gabriel was one of the founders of MLC and the firm's managing partner. He worked on the first floor, high ceilings, tall sash windows, antique partner's desk, no clutter, no dust, the exact opposite of my paper-crammed garret, in fact. He was the one who'd given me a traineeship way back when I'd passed the Law Society's entrance exams. At the time, I was distributing CVs like confetti to every law firm in Cork. I had no contacts in the legal profession and little hope of a positive response. Unexpectedly, I was called for an interview at MLC. Though, looking at the other candidates in the waiting room, most of whom I knew from UCC, I'd had the feeling I was a wild card entry. Yet, I clicked with Gabriel, and my meeting with him had gone as well as it could. All the same, with the possible exception of Gabriel himself, no one could have been more astonished than I was when he'd rung and offered me the job. I started a few weeks later, and I'd stayed for 16 years. That Friday, we chatted amiably, concurring on strategy as a lot of the time we did. I liked turning things over with him, especially when he was as relaxed as this, all too infrequent an occurrence. But he'd had a couple of big successes recently, and the finances of the firm were back on track after the violent death of one of the partners had led to a crisis that, for a time, had threatened to derail MLC permanently. As I'd been instrumental in helping the firm avoid disaster, my star was briefly in the ascendant. I wasn't enjoying my time in the sun much. I knew it wouldn't last. Almost as an afterthought, as I was leaving his room, I told Gabriel that Agnes had invited me to speak about the Mandy Breslin murder case at the upcoming Rule of Law conference at UCC. I told him what little she had said about the conference. I also told him that, however reluctantly, I'd agreed to attend. I'd expected his support. Even if I'm being honest, his praise. He was forever telling me to get myself out there more. Out there being a mythical place where potential legal fees grew like ripe yellow corn waiting to be cut. Instead, Gabriel went quiet. He got up from his swivel chair and walked to the window, hands in his pockets. He was small and slight and was, as ever, impeccably dressed in a beautifully tailored dark grey pinstriped suit and a crisply ironed blue shirt. After a while, he loosened his tie. Never a good sign. Without turning around, and quietly, he said, "I wish you'd run it by me, Finola." He was the only one who called me by my full name. "Right," I said. "Is it that you don't want me to go or something? Because..." I was going to say that I'd be glad of the excuse to say no, but he interrupted me. "It's not that." "Is it the topic? That it's about the firm? Oh, I'm sorry, I hadn't thought..." "Yes, Finola. I'm surprised you hadn't considered that might be a problem. Washing dirty linen in public? Best avoided, and all that." "I'll cancel," I said. "It's no problem. I'm actually delighted." I was telling the truth. He put his hand to his forehead and turned to face me. "On the other hand, backing out now might only make things worse." "He's a worrier. Then again, so am I, but I still thought he was overreacting." "Oh, I really don't see how it could. I can tell Agnes that something's cropped up I can't get out of. She only rang a couple of hours ago. It's not too late for her to find someone else." "Did she say why she asked you?" "I think someone cancelled." He nodded slightly several times. It's a tick he has. It means he's thinking. It also means he wants you to stop talking, and that if there's any more to be done, he'll be the one doing it. When he's good and ready. After a while, he sighed and said, "It's so hard getting trainees these days with the big Dublin firms coming down and stealing candidates who should be ours right out from under our noses. I don't want to do anything to damage our relationship with the university. So, in the circumstances, refusing isn't an option. Especially when you've already said yes. Go. But be as discreet as you can be. If you're sure." "I'm not." "But you still want me to go?" He shrugged. "Get in and get out," he said. "Don't linger afterwards." That was the moment when I should have insisted on cancelling my attendance at the conference, but I hadn't. And now Agnes had strong-armed me into agreeing to stay on for the conference dinner. I'd planned on being back at the office well before lunchtime. Instead, I was stuck there for the entire day. It came to me that military types call this kind of thing mission creep, and that terrible things usually happened as a result of it. War crimes. Massacres. I needn't have been as passive as I was, or felt as powerless. I could have walked out of the Aula Maxima at that very second, and no one would have been able to stop me. But I didn't, and that makes me think that a part of me sensed something malevolent in the air and wanted me to stay. So I stayed, which was another mistake. Chapter 6. I was woken from my reverie by Professor Casey clattering noisily out of his seat. Pádraic O'Flaherty was next, a lecturer in human rights at University of Galway. He was another good speaker, though if you paid me €1 million, I couldn't tell you what he said, apart from his opening lines, which were in fluent Connemara Irish. As he spoke, Beatrice leaned across to me. "Is this Gaelic?" "Yes," I said. "I like it," she said. "I wish I could understand." "He's saying it's an honour to be here, and he's thanking Agnes and the School of Law." "Thank you." She smiled, and we both turned to look at Pádraic. Mid-30s and red-haired, he was wearing academic, smart casual. Tweed jacket, checked shirt, corduroy trousers, brogues. He seemed comfortable in himself, and he made the audience laugh a few times. I recall observing that, if he'd been a bit taller, he'd have been seriously attractive. After Pádraic, we had the Q&A, during which, to my extreme relief, all of the questions were directed at the other panellists. Calling them questions was stretching it. As is the way with these things, in the main, people made statements, exhibiting their own knowledge, and seemed most interested in scoring professional points. I concentrated on looking interested, but uninteresting. The last thing I wanted was to be asked a question. I was mightily pleased when Agnes wound up the proceedings and invited everyone to take a refreshment break. And so it came to pass that, barely 2 hours after the welcome snacks, we were down at the back of the aula where, under the gallery, a catering assistant was dispensing teas and coffees. Cups and saucers and far too many chocolate biscuits had been set out on the trestle table. A polite queue formed quickly. I didn't join. I was standing to one side with Pádraic O'Flaherty. I spotted that he wasn't wearing a wedding ring, which, I told myself, was no indication of anything except that he wasn't wearing a wedding ring, and was, in any case, none of my business. He said a few nice things about my speech. Then he asked, "Are you going to the conference dinner?" "I am," I said.
"Are you sure?"
I laughed. Reasonably. "Sophie is going to require more certainty than that, I'm afraid." "Who's Sophie?" "Agnes was the one who said I couldn't get out of going to the dinner." I blushed. "Sorry, I..." "Sophie's the one confirming the numbers, though. Take it from me, she'll hunt you down. She takes her job very seriously. When not counting guests, she's Agnes's PhD student, I think." He smiled. "Where do you live?"
"Nearby. A short walk."
"Convenient," he said.
Was he flirting with me?
"Very," I said.
Was I flirting with him too? Oh, God.
He laughed. "I'm getting myself a beverage. Do you want one?"
Thanks, but I can't. I'll be climbing the walls if I ingest any more caffeine."
As I watched him walk away, half of me wishing I'd asked for something so that he'd have to come back. My eye was drawn to a group gathered around an older man I hadn't noticed until just then. He wasn't physically distinctive. Bespectacled men in their 60s aren't uncommon in universities. He looked fit enough, like he played an occasional game of golf or went for a slow jog one Saturday morning a month. Even from a distance, I could tell he had charisma. Twinkly eyes, the lovable rogue type. The kind who makes people feel invigorated, makes them laugh, which was what I'd picked up on. The too loud laughing, and when I looked, the expressions on the faces of the people doing it. Eager to please. Senan, the guy from Limerick I'd been talking to earlier. A few others I didn't know. and Agnes, laughing so hard that I knew he was someone she needed to impress. Him, Professor William Atkins, Chair of Common Law Jurisprudence at the University of Melbourne Law School, the conference guest of honour and keynote speaker. Universally popular, it seemed. But I'm getting too far ahead of myself. I have to keep to what happened and when. Chapter 7. Before the next session started, I caved and grabbed a black tea with a chocolate digestive. Then, before I retook my seat, I spotted the woman I assumed was Sophie, standing near a slight, studious-looking young man in a bow tie. I went over to her and told her I'd be at the dinner. She said, "So Agnes informed me." Nevertheless, she placed a tick beside my name on the list attached to a wooden clipboard. She was wearing wire-framed glasses and a buttercream-coloured twin set. She reminded me of a millennial Miss Marple. "You do know you're signed up for the campus guided tour as well?" she asked. What else had Agnes planned for me? I pinned on a smile. "What time's that?" 5 until 6. Then there's a PIMS reception in the President's Garden, weather permitting. She glanced doubtfully in the direction of one of the high windows. "It's supposed to clear up," I said. "Dinner is at 7 p.m. in the President's dining room, which is through there," she said. She gestured with her right thumb towards the door that led to the east wing. "Thanks for all that," I said. "Listen, Sophie, you don't happen to know why I'm here, do you? It's only that I wouldn't have expected to be invited, and..." She seemed surprised by the question. "Agnes just said to add your name, and I did. But as to why, you'll have to ask her yourself. I have no idea, I'm afraid, other than the obvious one." "Which is what?" That she wanted you to come? It's the way things are going. With sponsorship and all the pressure to get traction on social media, they often include a non-academic these days. A performing seal. "Oh, don't put yourself down," she paused. "You don't recognise me, do you?" Taken aback, I asked, "Should I?" "I was a summer intern at MLC 3 years ago. We didn't do much work together, though. Otherwise, I'd have..." "No, I was on Mandy's team, finance and trusts. I was so sorry when she died." "Me too," I said. "She was great. I went to the funeral. I wanted to pay my respects. I saw you there. It was good what you did. Afterwards, I mean, finding out who committed the murder. So much has happened in the last few years, I can only apologise for not knowing you now." "Oh, don't worry about it," she said. 3 years ago, I probably looked different. I had my hair dyed black for a while, kind of a 1920s bob." "Now I remember you. From the tea room, a silent movie star with a fondness for sushi at lunchtime." She laughed. "That was me. All that single-use plastic packaging. I don't know what I was thinking. Great to meet you again. We must..." I got no further because Agnes was up front of the microphone again, calling everyone back to their seats. Sophie mouthed, "Gotta go," and left me standing on my own. In mentioning the previous case, she had reminded me of how I used to be before. What little energy I had leaked out of me. Sneaking another biscuit from the table, I slipped into the back row, empty, but for me, making myself as inconspicuous as possible. On the dais, Agnes was going through the same sort of introductory rigmarole she had before, this time for the keynote address by Professor Atkins. At the far end of the row, a slim, dark-haired woman in her 40s slid quietly into a seat at the edge just as Atkins started talking. She didn't acknowledge or even appear to see me, but I recognised her as Professor Leah DeBarra from the UCC School of Law. She must have just come through the rear door of the aula because I hadn't seen her earlier. Not even taking the time to remove her expensive soft yellow coat, she sat up straight and listened intently. She wasn't alone. The atmosphere in the room had changed. Atkins appeared to have academic star quality. It was as if Benedict Cumberbatch had taken the stage in a student production. I made an effort to listen, but as keynote speaker, his speech was at least twice as long as everyone else's. My mind began to drift, and I found myself flicking idly through the conference programme. After a while, I opened my phone and started Googling. I didn't know it then, but my research would come in handy later. After the murder, I mean. Because everyone at that dinner ended up becoming a suspect, including me. Chapter 8. Before the question and answer session started, I escaped out the back door of the Aula Maxima. It was about 10 minutes to 1, and I needed to phone my assistant, Tina. She'd texted during Professor Atkins' paper, asking me to call her as soon as I could. I was glad of the fresh air and the excuse to leave early. I wasn't the only one, I noticed. Further along the path, in the direction of the library, Beatrice Membe was engaged in an animated conversation with another woman. I didn't recognise the woman from the conference hall, but that didn't mean she hadn't been there. Senan Dunford had left the aula too. Leaning against the back wall, he was smoking a cigarette and checking his phone. He'd done that thing with his tie that some men do, for reasons I've never understood, flung it over his shoulder. It made me smile. He smiled too and gave me a little wave. I waved back at him, then turned away and rang Tina. "Where are you?" she asked. "Still up at college. I got stuck here for the day. Sorry, I should have phoned to tell you." "You should have done more than that. You should be on your way to the courthouse." Oh, Jesus. 1 o'clock settlement discussions in Harry Bennigan's case. I'll meet you on the steps. Bring the file. Tell everyone I'm on the way. Leaving now. Running. Oh, thanks, Tina. If I'd been back at work, as I'd expected to be, I'd have seen the appointment in my diary. And because I didn't have to remember, I'd forgotten it. This kind of thing wouldn't have happened to me before, but my brain had turned to mush recently. And climbing the 11 steps at the front of the courthouse less than 15 minutes later, a lot sweatier and more out of breath than I would have been 6 or 8 months previously, I acknowledged that my body had turned to mush too. Admittedly, I'd had an injury. I'd been hospitalised after getting into serious trouble during the Mandy Breslin murder investigation, so I couldn't blame all of my disintegration on the breakup with Davy Keenan. Not quite all. In fairness, 99% was probably a more accurate figure. I paused beneath the Corinthian portico. During the day, the plinth operated as a sheltered outdoor smoking and consultation area. At night, surrounded as it was by busy pubs and nightclubs, the steps provided rest for weary revellers. I sent a message to Tina letting her know I'd arrived and went in by the left door. Inside, a substantial crowd stood dispersed under the dome, which told me that Family Law District Court was going on in Court 3, that the entire morning's cases had been bogged down by something interminable, and that the judge hadn't yet risen for lunch. When she did, the place would clear out for an hour or so as people left in search of sustenance. Meanwhile, the atmosphere was tense. Solicitors whose cases had settled gathered in a scrum near the courtroom door, clutching signed agreements, hoping desperately that the judge would take rulings before she rose and that they wouldn't have to return in the afternoon. I greeted several colleagues as I passed and walked quickly in the direction of the bar room, at the far side of the hall in search of my counsel. Feeling a hand on my shoulder, I turned, expecting it to be Tina with a file, but it wasn't Tina. Chapter 9. It was Davy, the lying, cheating, good-for-nothing who'd broken my heart into a million tiny little pieces and who, apart from a new but minor frown line between his perfect brows, looked as good as ever. Possibly better. 6'2", strong, his beard was gone, and he'd shaved his sandy hair into a buzz cut too short to run his fingers through but soft to the touch. Probably. He looked like a Viking after a makeover. His eyes seemed bluer. I looked up into them for a nanosecond and had to look away. "Finn," he said, "I was wondering if I'd run into you." I made no response. His hand was still on my shoulder, and my breathing had stopped.
I'm here for court. About Tom? I mean, everything's fine, really. Just sorting a few things, you know? Better to have it down in black and white.
Tom was his son, the one he'd had as a result of a brief dalliance with an ex while he was supposed to be with me. Technically, we were on a break at the time of the actual insemination, but that did nothing to lessen the pain of the betrayal. Plus, he'd known about the pregnancy for months, but I'd only found out about it after the child had been born. And he hadn't been the one to tell me. My best friend, Sadie, had seen him going into the maternity unit at Cork University Hospital, carrying a small suitcase with a heavily pregnant woman by his side. Even if she hadn't been a detective garda by trade, she'd have worked out what was going on. She'd never liked him, because of his past. I'd met him first when he'd been a client of mine. Sadie had known him because of a cocaine addiction that, to his great credit, he'd beaten. He'd gone to rehab and retrained, and I'd done the legal work on a lease for his gym, one of Cork's most successful now, with a waiting list to join. We'd become just good friends for a time. It was only after a few more years that we'd got together. But Sadie had never approved of the relationship. She'd never trusted him, and she'd been proved right. A while after she gave the news to me, I'd met him once, and once only, to confirm the way things had to be between us. Finished. Forever. Which didn't make it any easier. Especially as he and the ex had split up again, so, from what I'd heard, he was on his own now. I hadn't yet seen him with the baby, but I imagined them like one of those black and white Athena posters. I took in a gulp of air, and still, I said nothing. I was painfully aware of how bad I must look, my face undoubtedly red and horribly shiny after the rush down Western Road from college. "It's nice to see you," Davy went on. "I don't have a solicitor, actually. There was no need. Hers drew up the agreement and I just signed it, but..." I found my voice. "You're not looking for free legal advice, I hope." "Not at all, no. I was only explaining why I'm here is all." "Thanks, because it would really bother me if I saw you with another solicitor." "Would it?" "Obviously not. You can do whatever you want, Davy." At the sound of his name in my mouth, my eyes welled. I clamped them shut. Then, mercifully, I felt my phone vibrate in my hand. "I have to take this," I said. Davy's hand fell from my shoulder as I walked away. I put the phone to my ear and rubbed my thumb up and down the side of my neck, the same side as his hand had been. "I've been looking for you," Agnes Heaney said. There was a bubble of conversation in the background. The Q&A must have ended. "I was called into work urgently. I meant to let you know."
"But you'll be back. You promised."
I supposed that I had, and I'd just spotted Tina coming round the corner from Court 1.
"Ah, yeah," I said, "all going well."
I waved at Tina and ended the call before Agnes could say anything else. Chapter 10. Tina handed me my briefcase. She was 9 years younger than me and 80 times as fashion conscious. She was, as she said herself, Cork's most glamorous fat person. She had the kind of glossy red curly hair that Irish dancing wigs were invented to emulate. "I've given you the main brief, the pleadings, and two extra printouts of the financials," she said. "By the way, was that a certain person I saw you talking to?"
"It was. Just a few seconds. He's here for family law district court. Something to do with
the baby."
"Yes.
Things can't be too rosy with himself and herself, so," Tina said. "Would you ever..."
I shook my head wearily.
"Have you seen Mary Jo around?" Mary Jo was my barrister in the Bennigan case. "No sign of her so far," Tina said.
"She's probably in the bar room."
"And where's the client?" "I put him sitting on a bench in the atrium," she said.
He doesn't know you forgot about him. I made it seem like this was the plan all along. I laughed. It was, wasn't it? Then I said, does he have someone with him? No one here. No one on the way, Tina said. In a contentious divorce like this, having a friend or relative present for settlement discussions often helps to bring perspective. But some people value privacy over support, and I could empathise with that. One of the worst things about the whole Davy debacle was how it had made me a live gossip topic in the office, and worst of all, an object of pity. Though the talk had died down in recent weeks, this episode would serve to reignite it. All of a sudden, returning to UCC for the afternoon seemed considerably more attractive. I decided there and then that that was exactly what I would do. I could either keep wallowing, reliving my broken past with Davy, or do something else. Being at the conference and talking to people I didn't already know, including nice-seeming guys like Senan Dunford and Porrick O'Flaherty, was an opportunity. I needed to wake up and grasp it. You can head away, Mrs. I'll find Mary Jo and take the files home with me later. I'm not going to make it back to the office today. There aren't any other bombs going off. Not yet, no, Tina said. You okay? Why wouldn't I be? There it was. The "Shergod help her, the poor misfortunate" expression. Well meant, especially by Tina, but excruciating for me. I'm fine, honestly, I said. Now go and have your lunch, please. I located Harry Bennigan and sat beside him. Tina had placed him on one of the comfortable old wooden benches, wide in the seat and well worn in, a bit like Harry himself. He was a florid man in his 60s who bore a striking resemblance to his second cousin and sailing bestie Dermot Lyons, senior partner at MLC, and as a rule, my nemesis. But like I said before, I was useful to have around, especially for the kind of file Dermot called delicate. Despite his almost permanent moaning about the inadequacy of my pecuniary contribution to the firm, he funneled a surprising amount of work my way. Light flooded in on us through the glass roof of the atrium. The floor was glass too, though opaque, as the circuit court office was beneath our feet. Before the renovation, this area had been an internal void. Now it was the epicentre of the building. If you were looking for someone, chances were you'd find them here, or run across someone who'd seen them. How are you feeling, Harry?
At this stage, I want it over more than anything else, he said.
In my experience, timing is nearly the most important thing when it comes to settling a case. If Harry's wife felt the same as he did, we might be able to do business at long last. Come on, I said. We'll find a consultation room and have a proper chat. I punched in the code for the bar room and poked my head around the door. Inside, a set of curved antique wooden tables was arranged in a ring formation, like a massive skinny donut with an oversized hole in the middle. The surfaces were scattered with piles of documents and other legal detritus of indeterminate age and importance. The room was cleaned, but only around the edges. The table was never touched. Mary Jo, my counsel, was sitting at the far side, a takeaway coffee cup and bunched up empty sandwich wrapping beside her. Have we a client? She asked when she saw me. We're in number 6, I said. She gathered up her papers and followed me out of the room. We had a consent signed and witnessed by 4 p.m. The divorce would be ruled before the judge at a later date. I exited the courthouse with Harry Bennigan and loitered with him on the corner of Washington Street for a while. It had taken 2 years of angry wrangling for him to get this far, and barely 3 hours to tie it up in a neat little bow. Often, it was hard for clients to know what to do with all that excess emotion. Harry didn't seem to want to go home, but at least he hadn't mentioned going to the pub, the main reason he'd ended up in family court to begin with. There she is, coming down the steps now, he said. I wonder will she say hello to me.
It's not the end of the world if she doesn't. Life is long. Things change over time. I watched as his ex-wife, an assured ash-blonde woman, walked by us without a word. The woman with her nodded a greeting as they passed. Something niggled at me. I didn't know her, yet she looked familiar. I asked Harry who she was, but he didn't know either. I've never seen her before, but my youngest boy told me she's been getting advice from some swanky financial consultant. That must be her. He didn't tell you her name, did he? I did ask, but I wasn't told. I can try to find out if you like, now that it's all over. There's no need, I said. I thought I'd seen her before, but I'm probably wrong.
Chapter 11. It was after 4:30 p.m. by the time I got back to college. I went in through the back door of the aula as quietly as I could, but Senan Dumford heard me. He was sitting near the middle door, and there was a gap between his row and the front section of the seats, now tightly packed. Senan glanced over his right shoulder and grinned when he saw me. He nudged the man beside him, Porrick O'Flaherty, who made a big show of turning around in his chair and tapping his wristwatch as if to say, "Where were you?" Tiptoeing up the centre aisle, I sat in the row behind the two of them. I put my fingers to my lips in a shh sign and gazed mock-avidly in the direction of the lectern for a few seconds. But when I checked back on the two lads, they were both fully turned around in their seats, miming applause. I moved into their row and sat a seat away from Senan, putting my bag and briefcase between us. He leaned across. "You escaped lunch, but you're coming on the tour," he whispered. I gave him two thumbs up and settled back in my chair. I tried to engage with the lecture. The speaker was Professor Kirsty MacMillan from Queen's University Belfast, easily identifiable by her Scottish accent. I remembered reading in the conference programme earlier that she'd been born in Kirkcaldy, Fife. Hers was the final paper of the day, and I have no doubt that she was well worth listening to. Except that I couldn't. After a while, I took out my phone. No messages. I shut my eyes and attempted to concentrate, but despite my best intentions, my mind kept drifting back to the encounter with Davy in the courthouse. I hadn't seen him during the afternoon, which meant that his case had finished and had been ruled. I felt mildly guilty as I thought back over our conversation. He'd said that he'd signed the agreement in relation to his son without the benefit of independent legal advice. He shouldn't have done that, and even if he was a stranger, I would have advised him to get a solicitor. But he wasn't, and I hadn't, because his life was none of my business anymore. I told myself I'd done the right thing, even if it didn't feel like it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.